I have a history with this franchise. I got to do the first one and the second one. So I'd always hoped to be invited back for the third one. So when I got the call from Brian Burke saying, you know, we're getting ready to gear up on this the third movie, I said, that's awesome. And I said, I would just love to come along and do it. The interesting thing about doing the third movie and it not being JJ was it really gave us every opportunity to say we're not the third of three, that we're actually going to reboot. And it came along at a very interesting time because Justin, who came on board as our director, you know, had come from a very successful franchise that he helped build. And different filmmakers bring different things to the table. So it was interesting that, you know, the studio wanted to see the movie go into like a new direction. Having Justin was part of that. And then being able to say that we're not the third of three, that we're kind of rebooting, it all kind of came together. The idea was to get our crew out of their costumes. That was key, to kind of give a different look to the movie as opposed to always being gold, blue, or red. The idea was to find a way to get them out of their costumes so that the movie felt different. And then the next step was, okay, we've done the Romulans, we've done the Klingons, what new, you know, alien civilization do we want to bring into this movie? And we've gone deeper and we've gone more alien than we've ever gone before with our bad guy. So in the first movie with Eric Bana, he was a Romulan. In the second, it was, you know, Benedict Cumberbatch as Khan, who actually was human. In this movie, there's a real specialness behind the character that we've created in Krall. And I hope audiences really can appreciate the efforts and the time that went into creating this civilization, because it's definitely the toughest challenge we've had in the three movies. The quarry was the biggest location I've ever taken and made into a set. I mean, it was massive. It didn't look big, but when you look down inside and you saw our, you know, our big trucks and they looked like Tonka toys, it was like, wow, this place is really big. It was very complicated down there because it was either very dry and hot or it was very cold and rainy. We got really dramatically different weather patterns over a day or two. And because it's a quarry, it's like being in a giant bathtub. So when it rained, the water would come in from all sides and we had to pump the water out. And we had a couple of days where the pumps went out. We had a couple of days where the power got taken out. And we actually had to use our own generators to power the pumps. The only problem was we couldn't get to our set because the windstorm took trees down. So we had to cut the trees to get down the road to get to the quarry to use our own generators to pump the water. So we showed up one morning and the set was just 2 inches of water everywhere. But our set was also elevated, so it didn't prevent us from shooting. We just had to bring in more pumps to get the water out. We did Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol here, and we had a great experience. We did a lot of scouting around the world to figure out where would be the best vertical city for what we wanted to do. And I kind of felt all the time that this was where we would be, that this would be the best place to do this. And the fact that, you know, there aren't that many places in this part of the world that have sound stages was also an attraction. So the combination of the vertical city and the stages made this the perfect place to come. What is it about Star Trek that I think is important to audiences is about it humanity. It's about people getting along. And it's not so much about ships flying around, it's about the people that are on those ships. And as long as we maintain that, as long as we tell that story, the franchise will continue to be successful. Leonard was just a very special, you know, person and just an amazing actor. And it was to see the movies through Leonard's eyes were always, you know, very heartfelt and heartwarming. And for him to see Zach, you know, kind of recreate the character that he created was also special. So every day when Leonard would be around, it was always a different kind of feeling than when he wasn't. And, you know, it was like a parent. You know, you always wanted to make sure that, you know, you got his kind of, you know, you're doing a good job, guys, keep it up. And so he was like our mascot, you know, and losing Leonard was losing a big part of Star Trek. So we all missed him. Tom's a gray hair like me, so we're kind of more old school. And so it was great to see him get out there with his models and build his sets and walking around with them and bringing him to the set and showing Justin. And, you know, you get so used to a guy walking around with a computer showing you what, you know, in the digital 3D thing. And, you know, with Tom, it's all about, hey, you got to look at this. This is like, you know, I found this rock and I'm going to turn it into this, or, you know, I'm going to invert this. So Tom was an amazing, amazing collaborator. It's a very long process. You start out with conceptual art. You have a head, and then you have a costume, and then you've got to try and marry the two. And many times, costume designers will want to wait for the head before they design the costume. But we were in a situation where we didn't have a lot of time, so I was like, let's just all get along and Sonia, design costumes that you love, that you think would be interesting. Joel designed multiple different alien looks. And we would sit down and we'd start trying to marry the two.